bald Palaeokastro defends the purity of Prophetess Ilias Mountain. This is its physical and symbolic purpose. The fortress has no formal gateway. It can only be entered by a hidden passage into the realm of mountain wilderness. Energetic spiders are the gatekeepers, closing off the narrow, labyrinthine passage into a secret chamber with their tough, fibrous webs, which weave through the fierce, thorny vegetation and rocky barricades. Entrance is by respectful negotiation only. Rapacious invaders are unwelcome, and surely will they harvest only a handful of thorns if the sweetest fruits of the land have been trampled and abused. Palaeokastro Peak is located in the diametrically opposite corner of Prophetess Ilias from the lonely Almiro Peak. These two peaks are opposites in several respects. Almiro is lonely and isolated on the western edge of Telos, whereas Palaeokastro is situated inland and close to important areas of human settlement. Despite its remoteness, Almiro is not difficult to reach. Despite its proximity, Palaeokastro is rather challenging, both to reach and to escape from. The route to the summit of Palaeokastro Peak starts out along the road opposite the modern football pitch, just outside Megalo Horio. After passing the army base, a dirt track goes up to a concrete water tank, and behind that, the lower skirts of the steeply angled ridge rise sharply. Immediately, the hum of human life is left behind, and a corner turned into a different realm, where the heart of Gaia beats, and her presence radiates like the colours of a rainbow. Life is revitalized by the fresh dew of a newborn day. Birds sing out in praise of freedom, for this is their realm. They can play as they wish, and go where desire takes them. It is Gaia's law that they should do so. The broad ridge and the sun move together in a synchronized step, rising inexorably towards their zeniths. The shadows of night creep downhill, steadily exposing the mountain slopes to the blush of the morning. Soon, the hidden passage opens out into a sun-kissed landscape. To the northwest, the islet of Gaidranisi floats on the Aegean like a turtle basking in the sunshine, pausing to rest on its eastbound journey through the straits between Telos and Nisiros. The ridge narrows as it approaches its climax and is flanked by rocky towers which buttress the sides, forming into the crenellated top of a castle wall which overlooks the very heart of Prophetess Ilias. The mountain forms itself here into a natural fortress, the protector of the Butterfly Mountain. But Palaeokastro, as its Greek name implies, is also the site of a man-made old castle. Given its commanding position overlooking the intersection of the Misaria, Scafi, Eristos and Agios Andreas valleys, it occupies a strategic point. It also guards important sea approaches to Telos, from the south into Eristos Bay and from the north into the Agios Andreas coastal plain. It is, in fact, the site of one of three castles guarding this region of Telos. However, there is a significant difference between Palaeokastro and the others. The castles at Misaria, above the famous cave at Kakhadio, and at Megalo Horio, seem to have relied more upon human engineering in construction of built defences than the structure at Palaeokastro. The ruins at Kakhadio and Megalo Horio look and feel like ruined castles. The remains at Palaeokastro suggest a more rudimentary structure. The real defensive qualities at this site are created by the mountain location itself, for it is a rugged and high crag which is difficult to get at from any direction. The man-built walls just fill in a few gaps, and it seems likely that this castle never was much more than a few strategically placed walls. The quality of impregnability which which made it an attractive site for a castle, is what also gives this peak its challenging character. What it lacks in terms of solitude, it makes up for with a rugged inhospitality. Beyond the ruins of the old castle, the ridge continues in a southwesterly direction, falling to a dip and climbing again over another rocky top before it continues towards an intersection with the main ridge. The two ridges meet at the east top of Prophetess Ilias, which is a triple top summit with the highest point on the middle one of the three. From the east top, a descent towards the south leads to a broad col, beyond which is the rim of crags that support the flat top summit of the Agios Andreas Peak. The way down from Palaeokastro follows the top of what is left of an old castle wall, which acts as a guiding stairway off the summit crag. Further down, the passage beyond Palaeokastro is suddenly complicated at the top of a dome of rock whose southwest face drops steeply to the dip on the ridge below. Careful searching for the best line of descent is needed before climbing down this short but steep rock wall, avoiding entanglement in the thorny bushes which occupy the network of crevices in the rocks. With the obstacle now overcome, the way ahead climbs again over another rocky top, and then either over or around successive rock towers and outcrops. The castellated architecture of the Palaeokastro Ridge is experienced as a sequence of ups and downs as the traverse progresses. All around, the expansive views delight the eye and are rich rewards for the endeavour made to come here. The behaviour of this bird suggests it has flown through a substantial spider's web as it darted through the bushes, and is now trying to clean off the sticky fibres clinging to its feathers. Leading up to the intersection of the ridges at the eastern top of Prophetess Ilias, rear up sharply ahead, and a pause to locate the easiest line up and through the rocks is welcome. As I survey the crag, my eye is caught by a dash of colour against the pale complexion of the stone. A beautiful blue campanula is in bloom, proclaiming its survival in a protected location, away from the attentions of grazing goats. When I came, she wore flowers in her hair. Such sweetness I never knew filled up a well of joyful tears, each one soaked into the ground and mingled with the blessed spring which waters the mountain gentian. The way to the top forces a way through a break in the steepest rocks, but one or two short phases of scrambling are needed. Arrival at the top opens up views into the hidden west-facing side of the mountain. The neglected remains of the old church at Panagia stand forlorn and lost in this wilderness. The ridge turns south here, falling away from the summit towards Cape Agios Andreas. At first, the descent involves climbing down a series of short rocky towers before the ridge levels and broadens out and the going gets easier. Behind, the high peaks of the mountain gradually recede into the distance as the outlying Agios Andreas Peak gets closer. A short ascent through a break in the line of crags which surround the flat-topped summit quickly reaches a position directly overlooking the rocky cape, where a long finger of rock reaches into the sea before finally diving into the waves. Before falling into the sea, the mountain cries out one last time as a sharp pointed tower, and then is gone. Turning round to look northwest brings the beach at Liminari into view, seen here from an opposite perspective to the one from Almiro, and revealing that Liminari actually contains two beaches separated by a broad rocky promontory. It is not possible to see both beaches simultaneously from either of the viewpoints. Above Liminari, Almiro Peak falls in broad slopes. From here, there is a good view of Almiro Peak, the drawbridge which approaches it, the ravine which the Pandalimina to Eristos trail follows down, and the route of return to Pandalimina over the pinnacled ridge. The return to Eristos now retraces the route from Agios Andreas Peak back to the Col, and picks up the final section of the trail from Pandalimina, which traverses across the lower slopes below the Palaeokastro ridge and above Agios Petros. On these sun-scorched south-facing slopes, it is only the hardiest of plants that manage to eke out a living. A sparse vegetation clings on, but even here, beauty flourishes amidst the dust and the stones, proclaiming the vigour of living things and waving the colourful flag of victory. What Mother Earth has given, man takes away at his own peril. When I left, I took a handful of leaves, her fragrance she gave me from these flowers of the wild, so I would remember these times by her side, and dream of her always, free spirits entwined. When I left nothing behind, not even a footprint, only blood that was shed where the sharp thorns pierced, and cleansed my humble spirit, like the scourging of Christ, redeemed all for poor sinners. When I left, it was as the setting sun slipped its hand from the earth's. Farewell for now, but dream, I will return with the fresh dew in the triumphant new morning, rising from her waking sea, and driven on a guiding wind to that wave-caressed beach, I will again cross the shingle and seek her beyond the shade along the tree-lined valley.